pleasure for me to start the first meeting of our seminar in this semester. I hope the semester will be fruitful for every participant of the seminar. And we start with the talk of our colleague from Institute of Mathematics, Alexey Rudenko, with the talk, an estimate for Hausdorff measure on the set of intersection of several independent Brownian motion on Kramer group. Please, Alexey.
Yes, thank you very much. So today's talk will be about intersections of several independent Brownian motions. And to start, I will try to explain what would be in my talk. So I will consider independent processes. Actually, it will be what I call Brownian motions on Carnot group, or it will be solutions of specific stochastic differential equation, which I will show later. For now, it is could be just independent processes. And what I want to do is I want to take some function of each of the process and look at the intersections of the corresponding processes, multiple intersection, meaning that all functions of all processes has to be equal. This will be my intersection point, and the condition for this is written here. So the first function.
Maybe in this formulation, if you don't specify the nature of the process X, it does not matter that you have a function. You can just have processes F of X as a new process.
Yes, of course. But normally I would want them to be like Markov processes. So yes, you're right.
Initial processes will have some additional properties.
Yes, of course. I will because I wanted to give a general construction here, I could say they are Markov proof. For okay. Example, so that it is important for me anyway. So, so this condition can be written as this, and we can see that this condition is in fact is some kind of manifold in this space. Or more precisely, the point that satisfies this condition constitute manifold in this space. So, if we look for such intersections, so we if we try to study the probability that such intersections. Sorry, I have problem with scrolling. It's a slow bug. I probably should just do this. Maybe it will be better, but not much, I'm afraid. Okay, maybe I'll have to do it like this.
Okay, it's fine.
Okay, sorry for this. Maybe it will be okay. What I want to say that now what I want to study is this probability that we have such points in the trajectory of this, actually this is a mistake. This should be T1, T2, and so on, Tn. Yes, so that we have different times, and here T is not one but n times. Sorry, this is this what has to be here, and this is a multi-parameter process. We can consider it as a multi-parameter process, and we study probability of this multi-parameter process of hitting a set. This is somewhat known, although it is known that such probability can be estimated using so-called capacity for multi-parameter process. The latest, the most comprehensive work in this direction was by Davar Hashnavisyan, book in the book of multiparameter processes. And unfortunately for me, this capacity is not so easy to deal with. So I wanted to avoid this, instead, I will be doing trying a direct approach, somewhat direct. What does it mean? So the capacities is actually, it is known that capacity is somewhat related to Hausdorff functions, right? So what I'm trying to do is that instead of looking at capacity, I will look at Hausdorff measures. And it turns out that sometimes using Hausdorff measures, we can also study this probability and say that it's zero. So this is will be my goal. So I will make some estimate for Hausdorff measure, and from that basically I will obtain that sometimes I will have this probability. Okay. So next, yeah, and this is, now I will introduce my class of processes. So we have a okay, maybe I should not just read, but just say that Carnot group is a group with polynomial addition rule, and it is so that to each coordinate the correspond some PPQ, which is like homogeneous degree of this coordinate. It is integer, yes, a positive integer, and we have such property that the addition rule is homogeneous with such degrees with regard to this this kind of homogeneous map, yeah. So we multiply each coordinate by some power, and it turns out power of lambda, and turns out that it does not change the addition. So what does it mean? So it means that this is the main condition, and then we have also additional condition which specifies the type of the group which we have, so that if we take only first k coordinates that correspond to the degree one, then the corresponding vector fields in the Lie algebra will generate the whole Lie algebra of left invariant vector fields. It's basically the same as written here. And this, what is called Carnot group, actually this Carnot group is just a realization of abstract stratified groups. So called, this is a type of nilpotent Lie group. So, and for the processes, I will take n independent processes. So, and the number of processes, and each process is of the same type, but they can be with different coefficients and with different independent Brownian motions. This is Stratonovich integral, of course, and such definition allows me to immediately say that this process, we can actually solve this equation explicitly, because like I told you, the addition rule is polynomial, and turn out this is also polynomial. And moreover, if we start solving from the first row, then we can always solve it, because on each row it only depends from x from the previous rows. So we can always solve it row by row, starting from the first, and so we trivially have a solution, it's unique and so on. For example, this process is such process. So here GI gives us additional structure for this solution, because we take this coefficients LGI as by basis in the algebra. So we note that we sum by k, not by d, the number of, so we only sum over degree one coordinates, but I take the whole by basis, because it's useful in the following. So we consider such processes, and it is useful to know, I'm going to need to use this for this for my results. So they are exactly type of processes which are considered in the book of Fukushima, Shima Takeda, Dirichlet forms and symmetric Markov processes. So they are symmetric Hund processes in the sense of this book. And I'm not going to show this, but the next slide will basically explain why. And the next slide tells us that all these processes have a density. This density is infinitely differentiable and satisfies following inequality. And this result can be found, for example, in the book Varopoulos of Kostakov, Home Analysis and Geometry on Loops. This QI are important for the following. They appear in this estimate, right? So they are just the sum of all degrees for one group. And rho I here, I do not specify what distance, but it's there is a natural distance which can be defined on GY. I don't think I need to specify it because I don't need to know. Knowing that we have infinity dimensional density with such estimate, we can easily check that our process is actually a symmetric Hund process. So this is what I'm going to use.
Alexey, just please, can we go back to the example with Heisenberg group? And am I right that in this case, XT has density in three-dimensional space, but this density satisfy interest estimation. What is Q now for this example?
Q is 4.
This was my point. So this is not usual, for example, Gaussian estimation.
Yes, yes. I will come back to this, of course, because this is kind of an important example for.
But it is interesting because at least for first coordinate must have Gaussian density. Yes, and it is interesting that. Together they satisfy only this one, but the distance also changes, yes?
Yes, the distance changes. I will.
Okay.
I wanted to later to talk about, but yes, so the distance, the ball will look like this. So we have in two directions, we will have like epsilon for epsilon ball, and in the third direction, we only have epsilon square. Mm-hmm. So it will be like this. It will be very flat in one direction.
I see. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, and this direction, what's important, it changes from point to point. So it's not always the same.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, and what I wanted to say about some known results about existence of intersections of independent processes. First of all, what if we have just standard Brownian motion? There are a lot of known results. I did not want to give you all the references. I give you only my paper because there I have all the references, and because in this paper I studied the case of fractional. Well, it's not Markov process, but it's the first slide, right? So if we consider fractional Brownian motion, then we can have a condition for existence of local time. And existence of local time, we can derive the existence of intersections. So in fact, the critical dimension is 2n divided by n minus 1. Of course, if this is fraction, if dimension cannot be fractional, so it is not clear why this exactly is critical. But again, with generalizations like to fractional Brownian motion, we can see that it is in fact critical. So what does it mean that intersections exist if they are smaller and do not exist if they are greater than equal? And now coming back to that example of this process on three-dimensional Heisenberg group, where the third coordinate is Brownian, Olivieri, sorry. So in this case, there are no intersections, no self-intersections, as was proved in this paper, but they also prove, in the process of proving there are no self-intersections, they also prove there are no intersections of independent processes of this type. So if we have two similar processes, like in this example, they don't have intersections in the sense that I was written. So the probability of intersection is zero. Unlike this dimension standard Brownian motion, note that if I set n equal to 2, then we have dimension equal dimension 4, and for n equal 3, we have critical dimension 3. We have to have 3, right? So, what does it mean? It means that in dimension 4, we do not have intersection, but in small dimensions, we have two-dimensional, yes. And here in dimension 3, we have intersection, and small dimensions, we do not have. So transferring to this case, we have three-dimensional process, which does not have two double intersections, yes. Which means that critical dimension, not 3, but 4. And this means that critical, it's I know this because of my results, but yes, the critical dimension is not for dimension of the space, but for dimension of the process instead, so so-called homogeneous dimension of the process for this Q. So it fits actually. So for example, I know that yes, from this paper. We can see that there was examples there where it can be seen that the actual dimension that they have to use is dimension, this QE, not dimension of the space. Let me stop on that because I do not want to too much to distract this direction too much, sorry. So now I need to formulate my results. So I need to define Hausdorff measure, which I'm going to use. For this, I wanted to give you what looks like a standard definition of Hausdorff measure, but where diameter is calculated using special kind of not even distance, but pseudo distance. So this is, generally speaking, pseudo distance. So we take distances on each group and then put them in some power and only then take maximum. More powers can be different. This is my distance, which I'm going to use for the definition of the standard Hausdorff measure. Of course, because of this is pseudo distance, what does it mean? That instead of triangle inequality, we have an equality with a constant. So all the properties, most of the results will be the same, just constant will appear sometimes. I don't think, I think it's clear, so let's move. So what is the theorem? So we take a general Borel set. Here I do not use just H0. Of course, I want H0 here, but it does not matter for the theorem. We can take any Borel set. And this measure nu, I also want it to be a surface measure on H0 normally, but it doesn't matter for the theorem. We can take any measure nu. Well, we can take if it fits to this condition. Yes, so if we have such measure, such constant, so that this condition holds with delta smaller than zero, then we have such property of that intersection, that the process does not multi-parameter, this multi-parameter process does not visit the set V. So let me maybe discuss this a little bit. So what happens here is we take Descartes product of both and then look how it intersects our set and count the measure of this. So and with both becoming smaller, we look at the asymptotics and if the asymptotics is large enough, yes, so we can prove that there are no intersections. So basically the result. Yeah, and points of course has to be taken, which is important from the set itself, which we study. Okay. So let me know. Ah, yeah, and the second part of the theorem, if the equals zero, then we need an additional condition. I will explain later why I need this. I need additional condition, such integrability. It is interesting that this condition is very similar to the condition for existence of intersection. So basically, if I've write something like this, then it should be enough for intersections to exist. So it is very interesting that it arises here. But let's just ignore this condition. We can just say that X is very far from V in all coordinates. That will be enough because then the distances will be positive and this will be always.
So in these two statements, you tried to avoid the word capacity, but it is very close. Yes, this is like potential, and previous one is like a measure which cover equilibrium measure. Yes.
No, it's not equilibrium measure.
Yes, I understand that it is not equilibrium measure, but it is greater than. Yeah.
I do not know. You see, the whole problem of this. Is mm-hmm. there is no notion of equilibrium measure for multi-parameter process at all. Like I do not see it.
Yes, I just say that. It
so
is,
yeah, it may be similar, like, similar. Yes, maybe like, but not different. Yeah. We can't, it's hard to explain what it is, what is mm-hmm. equilibrium measure in this situation. So yeah, and here is the result is that corresponding Hausdorff measure is fine of the intersection with set V with trajectory.
Mm-hmm.
With probability one. So here, if delta is negative, we do not have intersection. When positive, then maybe there are intersections and we have some estimates for their set, the corresponding set. It is interesting to ask what happens if delta equals zero. I think that with delta equals zero, we do not have intersection two, but I cannot prove this. And why I think so, you will see after I show you maybe some examples. Okay. So to prove the theorem, I need to, okay. So what I want to do, I want to give you a proof, but to start, I need to give you main idea, and this main idea will be in form of lemma. And for this lemma, I need this definition. This definition, instead of covering set with arbitrary sets, we will only cover with such sets. It is enough for an estimate. If we can cover with this, then clearly with more sets to cover, we can only have a smaller Hausdorff measure. So we can only cover with these sets, and this type of sets is just the same as I was showing before. We fix epsilon 1, epsilon 2, epsilon n, and then we look at how many such such balls, we can say, such product balls are needed to cover our set. And this is the definition of this number n from A, the number of balls needed to cover our set A. What I want to do is I want to estimate the average of this number of balls, which can cover the intersection of some set with trajectory. And in the right hand side, I have here two multipliers. First one is integral by measure nu. From what is this? This is probability of visiting the ball by the process xi, for the process xi. So this is only for one process. This is why in the following it will be easy for me to estimate. And the second multiplier is the one that the infinum of all possible measures of this product of balls. So if I prove, I want to prove this lemma, and it is clear, yes, the idea. So if I can prove this lemma, then can estimate this probability, then I can estimate the expectation of the number of balls, and then obtain results for Hausdorff, and so on, Hausdorff measure, and so on. Now, what is the idea? What is the proof of this lemma? So the idea is the following. Maybe I should draw. So we have some set V. Actually, some set A, doesn't matter which one. What we can do is we can construct such a set of non-intersecting balls with centers in this A. So we take, suppose A is non-empty. Yes. So we take any point. I take the corresponding ball. This is just corresponding ball to some point in the set. Yes, with the center of this point. Then we look at all the other points. And we look if there is a point such that if we take this similar ball, then it is that it, they do not intersect with the ones that they already have. And we continue this. So we do this until we can add balls, we add balls. If we can't, we stop. It cannot be infinite because the set actually, okay, I have to be say that it's bounded, yes, but my set is bounded because its trajectory of the process is continuous. Yeah, trajectories of the process, and the process has continuous trajectory. So we have bounded sets, and for bounded sets, this procedure will be finite almost surely. We will have such. We will have such collection of balls always. But then if we enlarge these balls, we double the radius, it turns out that they will cover all the set. All A will be covered for sure. So here I double the radius and we have that they cover. What does it give me? It gives me the possibility to estimate the this number, because this number can be estimated just counting the measure of all these balls. We can count the measure of all these balls, and the measure of all these balls cannot be bigger than the measure of set A epsilon, which is the set the set A to which we add all the points which are close to the set by the corresponding distance. And this is my estimate basically. So what is needed to obtain this lemma is just take expectation. And of course I have to prove that this everything is measurable and so on, but it is possible because I can assume that we have a good here to n is in the wrong place. So, the process x is so that corresponding same algebra is complete. So all the zero measures, all the sets of zero probability are included. So with regard to any starting measure for corresponding Markov process. So then we can prove that corresponding set of process visiting some set is measurable and so on, everything is measurable. So this is how this lemma is proved. I think I explained the main idea. And when we have this lemma, then we only need to have one more ingredient. We need to have such an estimate for the probability of hitting a ball. I take closed balls here just for convenience, and I claim that the probability of hitting a closed ball can be estimated like this. I'm not going to give you full proof, mostly because if I do this, I'm going to need to reference a lot of known results from this book. So what is happening here is that there is a large theory developed in many books, not just in these books, for potential theory of Markov process, and specifically for this type of process that I am considering. But what is different from my process is that it is very specific, has very specific density, as I already showed you. And this allows me to produce this estimate. And I did not see anywhere the specific estimate for this specific process. Although there is, probably should give you a reference to another book, which called basically potential theory for this type of process. But there they do not consider probabilities at all. So that's they have everything, but they do not have probabilities. So I still need to connect their result in potential theory with actual hitting probabilities. So there is no easy way, unfortunately, to obtain this, but it is possible. What is the idea? The idea is really simple. This is just a hitting probability of Markov process, so it can be represented with the equilibrium measure. This is our hitting probability starting from x. And then this is basically rho power 2 minus q. This is exactly what we obtain here from x, y, right? And this measure mu is equilibrium measure. It is possible to show that it's less or equal constant epsilon power q minus 2. So this is kind of sketch of one possibility how to prove this. And then if rho is larger than say 3 epsilon, then we obtain this. And if rho is smaller, then this is just constant and we have an estimate by constant on above. So this is the sketch of the proof of this lemma. So now, since I have the estimate, I can use it and to prove this theory. How do I want to do this? So I consider such set A, which is intersection of the set V and trajectory of our multiparameter process. And I count the number of balls which with radius with epsilon 1 equal to epsilon power m 1 and so on. The number of these balls that can cover this set. And when I do this, then this probability from the lemma can be estimated as in this lemma, and this is exactly what we obtain. Except here the problem is here's the problem. So here I replaced all the distances by some positive number. I can only do this if I assume that originally all the points in the set V at some distance from points. Actually, here again it's a mistake. It should be y and y. So each x is not one x, but n x's in each xe is nrd. And the same is for y in v. There are n not coordinates, but parts of this y. Each one is nrd. And for we need to have following conditions. So each xi and each yy are at some distance. So what does this mean? It means that, for example, if n equal to 2, yes, so like two-dimensional space, so we have some set V, and what we look in some stored point in X, yes. So looking at all point, we have to look if there is a point at V that are close at, by at least one coordinate. Yes, so here we can see that there are such points that are close. And this prevents us from doing this estimate actually. So I have somehow to work around this. So to do this, I simply assume that the set V is such that this distance is greater than zero. Then I can do this, but next step is next step will be transferring this to the all possible X and V, yes. But for now, if we do this, then for delta less than zero, we have the following that lower limit of this is zero. Actually, expectation, I think it can be that it is the same right now. So if we, since we have this, then we have that basically the number of balls which can cover, which will cover A tends to zero, which means that it is this is integer, so it is zero starting from some moment. And so we cover our set with zero balls, which means the set is empty. And it means that there are no intersections. So this is how I prove the that there are no intersections with probability one. But again, I need to do it for general situation, not just for this case. And to do this, I need to just modify V. I just going back to the picture, what I can do is just cut our set V so that this part is removed and this part is removed. And look at the rest. The rest satisfies all the conditions. Because the condition is just for all points of V, something must happen. So if we erase some points, that it's still true, the condition. So
but it is not understandable of what you are doing in general situation, what you are cutting in general.
No, I'm doing this in general situation. Let me take general V.
Yes.
We from each V, we cut this. This only depends on X.
Mm-hmm.
So for each X, we do this procedure. We fix X, and for XH, we do this procedure.
Okay, but in the definition of UA, it does not depend on this. I am still confused with the picture. On the picture, you have some coordinates and you are cutting some pieces related to coordinates. But here, it is not so. You just a cut.
No, this is row Y. I again forget.
You just cut some part of V which are close to this X, yeah?
No, this again, what is this? Let me just again explain. Mm-hmm. What is Y? This is
Y is this is coordinate.
Yes, this is only one coordinate. Yes,
okay.
I am unfortunately I forgot the index here, so yes. So in fact, I'm each YIA is this and this mm-hmm. one. So yeah, I'm cutting just each coordinate around each coordinate. I'm cutting some
mm-hmm.
some
mm-hmm.
set, and then using some properties of the probability, it follows that if we have for set we have no visits, then we have no visits for set with U zero. So only one. When we cut one line, so it visits.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but it is in fact easy to prove that one line is not visited because the process corresponding process simply does not visit this point. And this is mm-hmm. it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it is interesting that I need to do this, And for Hausdorff measure, instead of this, I have to use additional condition, because otherwise I do not have any way to pass into the limit here, of a to zero. So for Hausdorff measure, I need additional conditions. Here, instead of estimating with a, I take distance and I take integral, and instead I just cross this epsilon here and what obtain exactly what is assumed is fine. So this is the proof for Hausdorff measure. I don't think I have to be more precise here. Okay. And yeah, I wanted to do some examples, but unfortunately, yes, I have only a very simple example and the one that I do not have a full proof of. So, but let me start with a simple one. The intersections of independent equally distributed Brownian. So what I want here to have each process is the same. And these functions are simply x. This is a very simple case, but it is also interesting. So we will have just intersections of independent equally distributed notions on Carnot. In this case, I did not write it here, but it is important that since we have to be this. Here we have to put like the first coordinate, the second, and so on. But since we are on H0, we have to be on this set V, yeah, and V is H0 right now. I probably should have written here, yes. So V is H0, and since it is H0, and H0 is the set where all coordinates are the same, so this all should be the same. So we have to consider this, and it is easy to see that we just need to consider this case because it doesn't matter, because this is very simple. What happens here with these balls? We take scalar product, but then we take surface measure on the diagonal, which means that in fact they intersected. So in fact here is the back measure. It is equal. Not maybe with constant, depending how define new, with the back measure of intersection of these balls instead. So yeah, so here we will, this will be always the case when functions there are no functions, basically functions identity. So we will always arrive to the back measure of intersections of the balls. This is what we have to study, and here it is obviously just the measure of the ball of one of these balls, these balls are the same in this situation that I'm considering. So now, remembering what was here, we have to, the condition for non-existent intersection is delta smaller than zero, which means this, smaller than zero, which means this. So we see again this critical dimension here. So this is exactly what has to be here. Unfortunately, again, Q equal to this is important because this is exactly the case for four-dimensional Brownian motion, and also this is the case for Brownian motion on three-dimensional Heisenberg group, the one with Levy area. It's also this borderline case. So unfortunately, these cases are not included in the theorem. So this is one example. And the second example, again, unfortunately, I cannot claim that I have a proof for this proposition. So what is the idea? So about a year ago, I gave a talk about existence of intersections for such processes. For the same process I'm considering today, but functions f was two-dimensional. Yes, so the function f was from Rd to R. So it is the same as saying I'm equal to my definitions. And in this case, I gave a condition which looked very similar to those, but there was a greater than instead of smaller than. And this condition greater than was enough to for intersections to exist. Now I want to say that if I have condition less than, then instead the intersection do not exist. Again, the equality, I do not know what happens. But actually it should be true, because what I have to do there is again estimate this poles. This I don't know. Okay, it is just not finished. I'm sorry, but I think it is possible, and then I will obtain this or something like this. So this theorem, what I wanted to say here is that this theorem can be applied to this situation. New result about existence of intersection for some material process. Okay, this is all for today.
Okay, thank you very much. And maybe somebody have questions or comments, please. So, can you consider a case when these projections have non-Markovian structure?
Well, you mean functions? So
yes, functions from.
Yes, there was no condition for them to be Markovian. Again, we return to the beginning. We just take H0 like this. We do not ask for function F anything except being smooth and non-degenerate.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. But you have no such examples, yes?
I do, but again, the examples of such functions such that it is easy. Look at this process. You just cross out W2 and you have no more Markovian process. It's easy. You can even add W3 threes to make it more interesting. Yeah? And then the question is, does it have self-intersection? Does it have? The answer is no. But for multiple intersections, I think it is interesting what can happen. For double intersections, I think it is clear that there are no, actually, okay, I'm not going to lie, but it's possible. I think I've already done it.
Okay. The next question is about your measure nu. Can you go back to the formulation of your main theorem one about this? So there exists such measure nu z, and it can be seen from the proof, you can estimate number of the balls which cover the set of intersections. Maybe it can happen that with the help of this measure nu, you can define the analog of Hausdorff measure, but based on this, for example, nu, and then you can discuss the analog of the Hausdorff measure of the set of intersection if it exists.
But what do you mean you with measure nu? Because how to we relate Hausdorff measure to this measure? What do you mean?
I just said that maybe it can be useful to define the analog of the Hausdorff measure based on the measure nu. When we discuss the Hausdorff measure, it is really based usual. Definition of the Hausdorff measure is based actually on the Lebesgue measure, because we just say we have some function, but from what? From the radius. So we have some function from the volume, Lebesgue volume of the pore, yes? But if you use instead of this h of radius, you use h of nu, then maybe you can produce a definition of the Hausdorff measure related to measure nu, and then say that the measure, this new measure of the set of intersections, yes, yes, here is h r diameter, yes.
So what I think that my definition is more general, because here you see it can be any function basically, and yes, here we can have any like even pseudo distance. So this is my very general definition, and in my situation, what is the problem with my result that I have to be very specific with the choice of this Hausdorff measures. Yes, but I do not understand what you're saying to relate to measure nu, because it's somehow already related. So
okay. Then let me simplify the question. Do you know something about the Hausdorff measure and Hausdorff dimension of the set of the self-intersection, of points of self-intersection?
Okay. So points of intersections are exactly this. So this is the set of H zero. Yes, this is H zero. So this is all the points where we intersect.
And these are the possible points. Yes, the possible points.
The possible points, but if we intersect them with trajectory, we obtain exactly the points where
this process occurs.
And this is the estimate.
When we have the intersection, yes, we have this one, but you only said that your h delta r1 r1 is finite, yes?
Yes, yes, this is the only.
Yes, yes, but maybe it will be interesting to have such statement that when we define such function h r1 rn, then we have such Hausdorff measure, and this Hausdorff measure is positive and is finite from this.
Yeah, I understand. Yeah, the fact that it is positive is actually could be interesting.
Yes, it is exactly. This is my point, that it will be interesting to have precise estimation, because as we remember, in the Euclid space, when we have one or several usual Brownian motions, the right Hausdorff dimension and right Hausdorff measure is based on the r multiplied by logarithm r. Yeah? It is written in Taylor's papers. Yeah, so it will be very interesting to relate. To find the right dimension and right Hausdorff measure in this case relatively to the distance, relatively to the structure of Carnot.
Yes, actually here it is especially interesting, because as you see, I have some parameters here. Mm-hmm. And for some parameters, yes, it may be positive, but some parameters may be zero, and I do not know which is which.
By the way, as far as I remember, I can do some mistake, but let me ask you about the law of iterated logarithm just for Brownian motion on Carnot in functional formulation. Does it exist or not? What can you say?
I cannot say for sure, but I did not see that. But I cannot be sure, of course.
Because it is related things, yeah. How it behaves in different directions, and this Hausdorff dimension of self-intersection, yeah.
Yes, but here again, it is specifically the case when starting point is far away from.
Yes. So, it is very different.
Slightly things. Different, but I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much for interesting talk, and hope this work will be continued. And Georgi, maybe you know who is the next speaker?
for yeah, next semester.
Next speaker is Kvartenko Mikola Ivanovich.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so then for today we finish and see you next week. Bye.
Bye.